All right. Hello, everybody. For the attendance of the seminar, they know that it is in English. I'm not sure about the guests who are just here for that. I hope it's fine for you as well. It's going to be in English. As I already told you and sent an email around, I'm going to talk about a piece that I, or together with a group of people, did almost a year ago in Oslo, and that piece is called Control. And today I'd like to show you a few excerpts of the piece and also talk about some of the motivations behind the piece and some stages in the development of the piece, how we put it together technically and how we developed the performance part of the pieces and everything related to that. We are in the fortunate situation that a few of the participating artists are actually in the room today, Sonja, Heinrich and Pedro. Then you will probably see all of them in the videos today too. Funny situations. But the good thing is that they are also here to help us explain a few things, and they can hopefully also share a bit of their perspective, how working on that on this piece came along and how that was. All right, I'm just going to start with a very brief little clip without explaining anything beforehand, and then I'll go into a few details and give an outline over the presentation.
Go down. Touch the man.
Hey, hi, where am I supposed to go?
I don't know, you decide.
Okay,
All right, that was a very short, more or less random excerpt from the piece to give more like an idea for the feeling of what happened there. But not everything is as dark and scary as this first excerpt might suggest. So what I'd like to do today is, in this presentation, talk a bit about where the piece came from, what the motivation for the piece was, and then how we put it together, how we set it up, and how we realize the technical side of it, and give a broad overview how the whole thing works. And the piece is then, as you then will learn, is structured in a lot of different smaller rooms, and all those rooms host different performative situations. And I'll try to go through all those individual rooms and give a brief overview of what happens in those. And then talk a bit about some of the artistic questions related to that, and highlight a few interactions that stood out, and then in the end give a brief summary. So Control is a participatory installation piece which works in a way that every 30 minutes, four audience members or visitors can enter a building, and in that building are equipped with sort of a wireless surveillance technology, which streams their perception, that is what they see and what they hear, to other control rooms where other people sit, and they then perceive exactly what those people are seeing as they navigate through the building. And the people in the control room give commands or controls or helpful advice that varies from situation to situation, and sort of leading the people, the visitors who have entered the building, through all those rooms. And That is the first step, and this is how the piece basically starts. I can give you a brief outlook how this looks in a schematic view. So on the right, we see this clock going down, which is the 30-minute circle of one loop, so to say. And we see that the people, once they enter here, then go through the whole building, which has sort of a maze-like characteristic. And what they see in here is then sent to those four control rooms. And in those four control rooms, people are sitting, seeing exactly what they see, and give them instructions and advice and whatever necessary to sort of navigate through that space. And then in a third and final step, in the second step, the people who have been sort of navigated through the setting then move one stage up, so to say, and enter the control rooms themselves. So the first 30 minutes, if you take part in the installation, you just enter this sort of immersive setting. And the second stage, after 30 minutes, you get into one of the control rooms and then communicate with one of the new audience members who have arrived. And then in the third step, there's everything that is happening downstairs is streamed to a big screen and to several smaller monitors. So upstairs, in a sort of public exhibition, you can then sort of follow what is happening downstairs and have kind of a surveillance overview look on everything that is happening. So the building where we realized this work was in Oslo and was provided by the Ultima Festival, who commissioned that work. So this is how it looks from the outside. It's an abandoned bank building, which was pretty perfect for this work, as it has a lot of different rooms and they were all quite empty, and so we could really do a lot of different things with it. And it also had, like, on a thematic from a thematic perspective, it had this sort of very powerful structure in a way. And as the piece also, amongst other things, deals with hierarchy, dominance, and also kind of organized or systematic structures, having a bank building seemed like a pretty fitting choice for this work. So the video technology that we used for the piece, I can show you a very little excerpt. This is how it looked when the audience entered the building. So every 30 minutes, one of the doors to the building would open and the people would enter in this room here. We can take a look. So that was sort of a bright room.
Right now, I just think about what's coming next. I'm not afraid of it, but I'm thinking way too much about it.
All right. So here we can see what you would put on. So it's basically one of those kind of VR glasses. But for the people who are going through, it's actually you look through them. They are more or less just a kind of a transporter or a host for the camera that is attached on it that we can see here. So that would then transmit everything you would see through those control rooms. The effect actually is that the side, if you look through this, is actually darker and a bit more narrow than it would be for the control room observer. So eventually, actually, the person in front of a screen in the control room would see more than you would see as you go through the building. So perhaps before I go into some of the details how the piece is structured. I can give you one additional small example how the interaction between the control room and the people walking through the installation can take place. And I'll show you a short snippet. So perhaps just that far. So it gives, I think it brings across this sort of kind of computer game-like or kind of virtual reality controlling somebody, walking through something and make it and adapting this perspective very quickly. So we can see that the people who are in this control room very quickly make sort of use of the possibilities they are given. And this is kind of the basic, let's say, form of interaction that happened. But aside from that, a lot of different possibilities were possible and also were happening. And that is perhaps a good transition to some of the thematic topics that we had in mind when working on the piece. So, as the title of the piece gives away, it has something to do with control in its various nuances, let's say, and closely related to that also with hierarchy, of course. And that is then linked to something, which I just abbreviated here with systems. So the idea was also to create something that would involve a certain logic or a certain set of rules, so to say. So the people are kind of entering a world with certain laws, let's say, or certain rules. So it's clear when you enter that there's a structure behind it. There's also a synchronicity behind it. And you are pretty instantly exposed to something that you have to relate to. So that is on a very broad level, but the idea behind that was so to make it necessary for the participants to relate to this order. And that is, I guess, one of the general topics to make it necessary to relate to or to interact with the setting and to decide how to behave towards it. So it's, for one thing, it's the topics of control, hierarchy, and how do you deal with that somebody tells you what to do, or how do you then deal with it that you can tell somebody what to do. So it's a question that has like some organizational questions, but also it's a lot about personal relationships. And so for one, it's this relationship between those two people, but then we try to design all the rooms in a way that none of them are like a concert or like a performance that you observe, but all of them were explicitly designed to make it necessary that you have to react to them in some way. So all of them have some more or less, let's say, social implications in some way, and you need to see how you yourself relate to that. And and the connotations in that are not so much just about this dominance thing, which I think in the beginning probably was one of the driving factors of the piece. But then as the piece went on, actually it turned out that some of the things are much more also intimate and also have a quite beautiful side to it. So the setting kind of allows both ways, and it also really depends on who's going through it and how the people feel towards it. So some situations can turn out this way and can turn out another way. And the, I guess the, let's say the palette of both positive and negative connotations in this sort of virtual setting is what was one of the major motivations behind the piece. So what I did not say at the beginning is if you have any questions, please always ask right away. So you can also ask at the end, but I'm happy to answer questions right away. Or also Sonja and Pedro who are here for the performer side and Heinrich who help with the dramaturgy and the choreography. So all questions related to that, you can also address to them directly. Or we can also discuss at the end. All right, so before I go into the concrete examples, perhaps I give you a quick overview what the space looked like from a top view. So I'm not sure if you can see anything, perhaps. So there are different forms. So this one shows, well, all the rooms that are there, and it shows also, well, here it shows the performer names, and it shows the names of the rooms. So I think there were 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. I think there were 10 major rooms, or 11, with clear, let's say with clear performance situations, and then there were different rooms that had more of a installation feel to it. So here the people would enter. So the one short video that you saw with the bright light where the people had the gear on, there was this room. Then next to that were the control rooms. This is where the people would go in the second stage once they would control somebody else. And all the rest of it is where people are free to kind of navigate around. What was super helpful is that that it's basically two circles, so you can more or less get everywhere from each point. And it was still kind of possible to manage the size of it, but it was, if you entered it and didn't know the building, it also was difficult to really make out to understand the structure right away. So it had kind of a good balance between the size that made a lot of things possible, and it was still kind of not too big to be impossible to handle. So let's see what else is in here. There are different things that show some of the technical parts of it. Here's a outline how the audience would move towards the end. Perhaps I'll say something about that in a little while. So here's like the total overview, including all the props and the things that were used for the stage design. There were basically two technical challenges for the piece. One was to set up the wireless video transmission, especially because all the walls in this bank building were super thick. So that was one of the big challenges, because we had to find something that was strong enough to transmit through all those things. And the other thing was how to synchronize the whole thing, because we had in total like 20 rooms that were not connected directly to one another. And the question, like from a technical point of view, was how to bring all those things together, because everything ran in a loop and would relate to one another. So basically we kind of had like one main computer, or that kind of where everything went together, that was located here. And then we had several let's say substations that ran more or less in sync. And from those are the blue ones, the computers, and from those sound and lights would be driven for the adjacent rooms. So it was kind of, for me, the first time to distribute a thing like that. Normally I would always run everything kind of top down, but that actually was helpful in several ways. For one, finding or eliminating errors. And the other thing is, and probably I'll come to that too, is how to actually organize and how to rehearse a piece like this, because you can't really do everything at the same time. You can't always have more than 20 people in the exact room and then run everything in parallel. So it was a bit of a question to also make it into smaller, smaller sections that could be worked on independently. All right, so perhaps before I talk too much theoretically, I'll give a few little examples again to give you a bit of an idea what the actual experience in there was. So everything we see is when the people went through the installation, it was recorded, what they, the communication that they made and what they were seeing was recorded. So the documentation here that we see is not a typical documentation where a video person was recording something, but that is the actual like first person footage of the participants. So let's take a look.
Looks like it's the area where they are living.
Yeah, it does. It does. Really.
Close your eyes.
Should I do what the voice says?
I don't think it's a good idea because it's... You wouldn't see anything when you move in this. I think we have to escape this room because I have the idea you can't do anything for this person.
All right, there's one sample, and here's, so we can, well, it's, in some of the things we can see that for all involved people, it's not really clear how the thing works, and it's always also kind of, amongst other things, a process of trying to figure out what is happening within the within those walls. Here's another section that illustrates that a little.
Do you want to take a bite out of the peach?
It doesn't seem so good, but I could try. Do you want me to?
Do you want to?
Not really.
Okay.
But I feel like you're the one deciding here.
You feel that?
Yeah.
Why would you feel that?
Because I have no clue what's going on. It seems like you do. That's really crazy. Maybe I'll take a bite.
So, one thing that this here also illustrates is that the people who are entering the building don't know that the people they are talking to are also just audience members. So it is basically at some point when you enter the building, so you're in this bright room and then you go through a door, and from that moment on the audio connection is turned on. And so it's also for both sides kind of trying to find out how to deal with this how to deal with this situation. All right, in total, there were like 12 rooms that we played with, and I think a total number of 22 rooms that were accessible in general. Here's a small overview of some of the rooms that we can see here already. And in a second, I'll go through the different individual rooms and then try to highlight a few things that were relevant for them. And before I do that, we can perhaps take one look at how the control rooms looked. So in the control rooms, the people had a headset and a microphone and a screen, and would on that screen see what the people, well, the person they were linked with would see. So this is how one of the control rooms looked like. And there was also one kind of tech room where everything went together. That is where we were sitting and kind of checking if everything went okay. Also, well, looking for technical problems, but also looking to see if everybody was okay in that setting. So there also was a safe word to, because some of the overall nature of the thing also has had a certain intensity. So that was also a thing to take into consideration. So basically that is where we were sitting and sort of supervising everything. And beside that, we did one more thing, and that is there all the video streams from the four visitors came together, and in the exhibition upstairs there was this one big screen, and then we also down there kind of decided always which section would be seen on the big screen, and there would also be smaller ones where the four perspectives would be streamed continuously. All right. So is that halfway clear so far? Are there questions by now? Yes.
How did you manage to tell the people that they should switch, that they should go to the control room and then
yeah. That's a good question. For that, I have prepared this confusing chart. basically, what happens is it's a 30-minute loop, and after I think 22 minutes, something happens. There are general announcements that come through speakers, and also the light and sound in the rooms changes, and from that point on, everybody leaves the respective rooms and gathers in one central room. So that is, wait, I actually also have this graph. I have this prepared here too, I think. Oops, but for some reason it doesn't let me jump the way I would like to. Why? There it is. So, after the roughly like 22 minutes, I think the process started, you can see those red lines. So what happens is that all the people then would come out of their rooms and kind of drag the audience with them. And then they would follow those red lines. Here at the red ones, people would be blocking. So actually here, the person blocking here, we have in the room, that was Sonja and Pedro. And like that, we kind of navigated the audience stream leading in this room eventually. And in parallel, there was also another thing in the control rooms where they had these monitors. We had the possibility to blend or to show text in there. So sometimes we would switch from the perspective that they would see and just blend in a black screen with a sentence. And those were mainly two things. At the end, it was, now you have to follow the others. So at that moment, kind of a general movement towards this room started setting on. And the people in the control rooms at that moment then told the person they were controlling that they should follow the others. So that happened, that all led here, and then four of the performers involved in the piece then each took one of the audience members and brought them to one of the control rooms. So that is how it happened. And once the people, so for example, one person would, in this case, well, one person would bring the audience member here. And before that, another part of our team would have brought all the people from the control room in parallel while this was happening already to the third stage. So while the people were all gathering here, somebody would pick up the people from the control room, emptying the rooms. Once that had happened, in parallel, the other ones would then bring the people to the control rooms. And in those rooms, on the screen at that moment, there was also a text message that said, wait in this room and wait for further instructions. Then shortly before the loop would restart, this message would turn to something like, in a moment you will see through the perspective of another person, give this person instructions to navigate through the building, something like this. So the whole communication was non-verbal, but surprisingly that all worked quite well due to this super cool diagram. All right. Any other questions? Yes. Yes. Yeah. So, I mean, the thing is, there was no real right or wrong or no what they had to do. Basically, they had to do what the people in the control room would tell them. But also those instructions actually were very often actually not really like dominant control-like, but very often more like helpful and sensitive too. But there were situations where the participant didn't want to do what the situation offered, and then they actually also said that they didn't want to do it and went away. But often the form of communication between the control room and the person in this setting was quite different. But I don't think there was. Yeah, but I mean, there were definitely situations where people didn't want to do what would be possible to do. So that definitely happens. And that was also completely planned for. So, I mean, it was more, the whole thing was not, if a person would come into the building and would say, I find this so scary, I want to stay at exactly this spot for the next 30 minutes, then that could have happened. That it would have totally been okay. So there was no... it was also, the whole thing was also so big, or designed so big, that it was would be impossible to do everything. So by design there's no right and wrong. And there's also, it's impossible to do it completely, and people can, and have done it really in different ways. Perhaps that's one... last thing before I jump over to the rooms, is that the several stages have, of course, different, or there are different reasons why to work with them. One of them is to, well, actually have this thing of controlling and being controlled. That's the most prominent one. The very strong one is the differentiation between being in an immersive setting as a person in contrast to just witnessing it through a TFT screen. So whether to be there in flesh or whether to be there kind of in a virtual setting really does something different with you, also especially with those intimate moments. So doing something in two different ways and also doing or looking at the same thing in two times over. So first you go through there yourself, and then in a second time you see the whole thing again, but through the eyes of somebody else, just on a screen. So this experiencing the same thing with two perspectives or through two different eyes, let's say, is, I guess, one of the chances of the piece, hopefully. All right. So,
just one question.
Yes.
Did any one of the controllers ever disobey?
Well, there was nobody who did not want to control or communicate.
There was one situation, wasn't there, when one person didn't speak at all?
But I think it was more a misunderstanding, I thought. So.
But this person, didn't we go in then and tell?
I think so. That's true. I mean, the thing is, yeah, that I think, especially at the beginning, we kind of overdid it with the not explaining how everything works. So we really tried to, there was barely any information at all. So it was really about finding out yourself. And I think at the beginning, we tweaked it a little to avoid this sort of situation that some people, I think at the beginning, didn't know that they actually had to speak. So that was not good. But aside from that, not. But it was clearly visible that a lot of people did not want to be in this controlling position. So that, I don't know if you want to, I don't even think it's correct to call that disobedience, because actually the whole setting was not, was open with regard to that. And that is actually, so I think I had that prepared rather for the end of the talk, but perhaps I can also now say one or two words with regards to that. The development of the piece, so there was like this, the technical part of it, and then how we worked on the roles and improvised with that. But what was interesting is, and that is why I'm jumping to this now, is that I think when I first started thinking about the piece, I was thinking much more about this control part. And then we did like a very basic test without any music, without any roles, any performative situations, just giving people the gear and see what happened. And that actually was pretty insightful, because some of the strange interactions and things that happened that were far away from control, but some of them were then intimate, or some were funny, some were weird, some were kind of abstract. At some point there was people kind of, like grouped themselves and kind of not being individually controlled by somebody else, but then three of them just went somewhere under the roof and sat on chairs there in a group. So like those sort of group processes was were interesting, and were also then in the early tests showed the openness of the system in a way. And that was also a challenge to develop this piece that it would be open enough for people to actually, that would make a difference how the people would interact with that. So it was kind of a balancing, trying to find something that would, you know, in some way be artistically strong perhaps, and also would convey this idea of a system or organization or some social situations where you would have to relate to, but then not making it so stiff that you just observe it as a performance, but that you actually, that it can make a difference how you interact with that. And that was one of the big challenges, I think, in the development of the piece. All right, I'm sure there's a lot of other topics to talk about, but probably we'll also hit those as we go through the rooms, and perhaps you also want to see a few examples and not just hear me talk. So the first room is misleadingly internally called the pause room, which I probably shouldn't even put in here anymore. That's a room that offers, I think, three different settings. Perhaps let's start with this one. Well, let's first look, and then I'll say a word about it.
Oh, there's a free chair.
Yes, so you can play the game now.
Okay.
He'll guide you.
Now I will show you a room that is locked, that you cannot enter.
So try to turn some of the bricks there.
Okay. Turn it back.
Yeah, try to turn it back.
Now, I will show you the room. For that, you will need a key.
Okay, you have to find the key.
All right, so I'm not sure how clearly visible it is here in the projection. On those, that's a memory game with photos of all the rooms in the building. And so it kind of gives the impression of that is basically the closest thing to a map that you can find within the installation. So this sort of implies some sort of a logic let's say a tool to kind of understand how the whole thing works, but that is actually more misleading than actually true. But then there are two other things, and one this section here is one that's the one with the clearest having to do with some kind of dominant or more aggressive behavior. So let's take a short look at this.
Look in the box. Okay. I didn't hear you.
So that is one of the more kind of direct in-your-face interactions. There are also here obviously different ways of how people dealt with that. I'm actually going to just jump very quickly towards a slide I've prepared rather for the end. That is exactly in the same room, but with a different pair of people. So we can take a very short look at this.
Now pick up the box and stand over him and dump it on his head.
Look at me.
Say, tell him, look what you made me do.
Look what you made me do.
Now throw the box on the floor. Pick up one last tiny newspaper. Throw it at him. And leave the room.
So...
Yeah,
so I think that serves as an example that people also were able to, you know, formulate their feelings and sort of react back. Sorry?
Where come from these boys? Come from the control?
Yes. So in that case, the female voice was from the control room, and the male voice was the person in the room.
Okay. And that is true person in in this room, in the video?
Yes. So, well, if I jump back here.
Yeah.
So we see through the eyes of the person in the room. That in the previous one was a guy, and the person in the control room is a woman, Chalin, this person who looks like who looks at the other person. So yes, there are two. This person we look at is a performer, that is Leopold Hurt, that's the cither player of Dakota, and cleaning enthusiast, and no, that's not true. And the first person perspective is the it's the perspective from a visitor, and the female voice is the woman sitting in front of a TFT screen in the control room.
Yeah,
ah, yeah. Okay, I guess we're... Ah, yeah. So, if I jump back to this... You talk about this one? So, yes. So, here, we just see... That's actually a very good point. We just see the audience members here. But in this area, there are also roughly 20 performers.
20.
Who are in the rooms doing strange things. So, so everybody wears those things, both performers and audience. So, in theory, it was a bit designed that it was not so clear to differentiate. I think in real life, actually, people were able to tell the difference. But the performers did not have like special clothes or something. I mean, they were wearing black. But aside from that, so like this, they could have been, and they were wearing those glasses. So it was designed that there would not be a differentiation, but yeah, I mean, that didn't work 100%. But one, aside from making everybody look the same, one important thing was to, you know, if you put this on, it totally does something with you because, it obviously takes away your eyes. So the whole interaction right away becomes much more, abstract and virtual in a way, and more distant. And but the thing is, it's interesting with this thing. So for one thing, it creates a distance, but on another level, it actually also makes some interactions easier because you don't have to look another person in the eye. So sometimes it actually can also decrease the boundary of interaction. So that was another reason why to mask everybody in the both performers and the audience.
Sorry, I have a very small question.
Mm-hmm.
Who sees and hears the glitchy things?
The glitch stuff?
Yeah.
All right, so right now, I should have probably said something with regard to that. So what we see are some transmission glitches that the people in the control room would see. So what we see is exactly how the transmission came along. As this building was so super heavy with the thick walls, there was always some small glitches happening. But so when a person was in the room and the signal would be sent to the control room, sometimes something happens on the way, and this is where the glitches come from. So the glitches are not designed, they are actually, so it's all analog video hardware, and those are just real life glitches. So we actually first tried to really, it was a really tough way to make this even happen there, and now they're just the leftover byproducts of the thick walls, actually.
And the music, the sounds, they were like electronic sounds, right?
Yes, so there are no instruments in the whole building aside from one, that is the pianist. And the pianist was locked away in a room, so where nobody could eventually see him. But he was playing very beautifully for all the time. And only in the third stage, in this exhibition part, there was a monitor, like a live transmission to him playing in this locked away room, and there we could hear him. And there was a phone, which if you were in the third stage, you could pick up, and then he would get up and go to the phone, and you could tell him something. But he would not answer. So that is the only live instrument in the piece.
Could I ask a question?
Yes.
Is that all items is that you bought after you arrive, or they're just all there?
You mean whether all those things were there already?
Yeah.
unfortunately not. So I should have actually brought a photo of how the van looked with which we came there. So no, we actually brought a lot of things. So we got some props from a theater.
It was a truck.
Yeah, it was a truck. It was a full scale truck.
Yeah.
So we got like one truck of furniture and stuff from a theater, and then one truck of stuff we brought from Hamburg, which was a combination of super high tech stuff and like old mattresses I got from some old from festivals and some trash we've been picking up everywhere. So actually the day we arrived at the festival, kind of the faces of it didn't come across so super professional, those like old mattresses that we brought and stuff like this. But in the end it was okay. All right, I'll try to power through a bit to give you some additional views into the piece. So there was one room, the office. Let's just take a short look. There's Jonathan, our decoder percussionist.
There's a light. There's a camera.
That's actually his daughter.
Follow his instructions.
All right, I'll jump to another little section.
How do you feel that we are being watched?
I feel like I'm being watched all the time. it's strange, it's pleasant, it's but okay.
Is he trying to tell you something?
Maybe he wants me to help him put this back up.
All right, so those are two examples in here. So there's a pretty much a one-on-one situation where he actually also would ask the audience questions, and that was actually one of the, basically I think the only room that included some short actually verbal interaction. Well, I'm not doing all those rooms real justice, but I'll think I'll try to jump through them a bit quicker, and I'm thinking perhaps I'll next jump to a room where we have two performers also in the room, because that might be nice to perhaps answer a few questions directly from the involved performers. So this room is called Errors, and it's basically divided into two parts. The first half is what we see on the left, and the second half is what we see on the right, and they are quite different. Perhaps we'd first take a brief look at the first half.
Been in there.
No.
Thank you.
So this for one is definitely one of the more intense rooms, and also I think the one that is actually where the first half is the most like a like an actual choreography or like structured performance really. Here's a bit how well kind of the score to the piece looks. So it's that piece actually was realized, or this half was realized with a click track, so it was actually very much in sync with the with the lights and the electronics. And I don't know, perhaps would you be interested to say something, Sonja or Pietro, in the how that worked out for you?
Actually, the first meeting with Heinrich and Alex, we started to develop a way of movement on how these half-human beings could move. So they were not supposed to be robots, but the movement also were not supposed to be completely natural or human or spontaneous. And from this first meeting, so we tried out all kind of ways of walking. So from the starting point, we tried to develop this special room, the arrow room, and with Peter and me. And obviously the movements do have a sexual connotation, but everything was supposed to be broken, like a damaged sex robot or something. Yeah, the kind of movies we developed together with Heinrich and Alex. And you see the score, so it's not really fixed what kind of movements it is. So we developed and we did our own score with the movements, and it was always the same. So we did six run throughs a day in Oslo. And it was actually quite exhausting thing to do. but maybe.
I think it was interesting, like how. So we were asked in a way to also find what would be the best fitting movements from our own. Like even if we were trying with them, we were asked to find, okay, how would you do these repetitions? And then from our own positions in the space and from the exercises, we kind of define the final. Piece. And the structure was, I think, not from the beginning given, but Alex, after we did some trials, like it was very, very clear how the click would work. And also, so we first developed it here in this room, and then when we went to Oslo, the room was a bit different. And also part of the positioning that we made in the room, we have to change it in order to work better. Also, I think it was important that like the room there had different features, not only the form, but also, for example, the position of the chair or things that were on the walls that didn't exist here, and then we kind of adapt to that. And I think it was also interesting, well, these two aspects, like the super violent aspect and also the sexual connotation that the whole thing had. And also that there were like two kinds of, I think, of way of working together. We did something that's very individual, so each of us were working on our own, like also kind of taking care of what the audience were doing, and other parts were really interacting between each other, so looking in each other's eyes and kind of, you know, having something more like a dialogue between us. And I think in general it was really, really interesting to develop that. And I think also like the whole multimedia part, like the lights and the sound, was really making it super strong to do it there. It was really, really interesting.
Mm. And also the room design, I mean the ideas came from Alex and also I think partly from Heinrich. So it was just a normal wide room, and we it took us one day to put all the plastic foil, the black plastic foil all over, and we also hang the lights, like which were programmed then. So also the design was like made by the participants. do-it-yourself project. So,
yeah.
Also, to see the movement we do, like with the, we work a lot of how to repeat movements, in which tempo, in which amplitude, but it changed completely with the flickering lights also. So it was something to develop further when we really arrived in the setting and we worked with given conditions.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's good. Yeah, it's actually 2 points. I think that's good that you pointed that out. The one thing that it's actually each day 6 hours of performance and half hour loops. So that was actually really a challenge.
12. I said 6 days. I would tour 12 hours.
Yeah, yeah. 2 days each day, 6 hours. So, and the days before that, actually, it was like really full from morning till night. Like there were so many cables to be laid and really making. So the rooms were white when we came, and we actually brought like all those well, the furnitures and hanging the walls black and stuff like this. So yeah, that was actually a pretty heavy group effort.
Or maybe one interesting thing, because we discussed a lot about how will people react on us, and I didn't believe anyone would touch us actually, because I thought if I would go in such an installation I would never touch the people, but actually they did. So, someone even carried me, a man, and like took me to hold a room, and So, and I don't know if somebody, if he was told to do that, or if it was his own decision. So, the funny thing about this controlling situation is that you, as a performer, don't know why they do something. And I think the fact they are given advices what to do also changes their behavior a lot. I thought like sometimes they see us as objects, not like as human beings. In a way, it was never the way we would have stopped or said no, don't do it. Or it was kind of nice. So also maybe we also see the next scene, which is also even closer.
Yeah, perhaps you can jump to that now too, but. Yeah, it's true. This, I mean, the questions of how the interaction between the people in general there happened, because it was layered in different thing with the control, you kind of also in a way are able to sort of just zone out and just take, you kind of also give away the responsibility in a way. And then the thing with the being masked also takes away some of the responsibility. So it's true, it was actually difficult to judge how the things would really work out. And one way we found in order to cope with that is that we rented a building here in Hamburg where we were rehearsing for a week, and we were starting with all those rooms rehearsing them, and then we would kind of circle around all the time, that the performers would then go into the other rooms as test audiences and see how it would work out. But still it was difficult to judge. And here's, for example, another scene that was one of the more difficult ones to see beforehand.
Ha ha ha.
perhaps up to this point. So, yeah, we see that the second half is like in comparison to the first one, not so synchronized at all anymore, but much more, much freer in a way. And, well, obviously the kind of sexual connotation is still is pretty present in that room. I think when we were rehearsing it here, we like really had strong discussions whether people would eventually even go on that mattress and engage in this thing. But I actually had the feeling that nobody was not.
Yeah, actually everybody who came to the room also sat down.
Yeah. So I think one topic, I mean, here was also to find the good way for the performers to work with this room, to find a good role for yourself, or how to deal with this situation, because it also was so free in a way. It was a bit, there were some unpredictabilities, so it made it necessary to actually, if I remember correctly, also adapt to a setting and then see what happens, perhaps more than in the other thing, which was more like a had a much clearer plan.
I think it was interesting also, like comparing two rooms, like in the first one that we had such a clear structure to follow. Still, it was nice if we interact with the audience coming in. So it was all the time I remember doing it and try to find a balance between, okay, now I have to go to this wall there, but actually the person is there, so maybe it's better that I go to the other wall and I do it in front of the person. Things like this to make the experience more intense for the audience. So also improvise, but at the same time follow the score in order to be with the lights and be very concrete.
Yeah.
It was interesting because it created a very specific way of interacting, I think. It was very aggressive, very like, okay, now I go in front and I stop until the lights go on. It was very defined. And the second one that was more free, it was also interesting that you had to find much more, okay, what should I do now in order to, you know, to construct something that makes sense for the audience. And it's interesting, but at the same time, I'm like provocating. So how I cope with this provocation, or at what point I go, and then I see how the audience react. And it was quite intense to think in the moment how to improvise with this material.
Yeah. What I actually feel now, I felt now that I remember it, is also when I did it as a test subject, I felt that in this room, this thing, who's in charge or who's kind of in the hierarchy up or down, was actually sometimes switching very quickly. Sometimes, for example, if you entered the room and one person was lying on the mattress, you actually feel like weirdly, I don't know, like in a place where you don't want to be, like the connotation to it puts you somewhat in charge, which is also not pleasant. But then, for example, if you sit down, there were moments then that both performers just stood up and looked down at you. So with a short switch, actually the tables have been turned very quickly. And this kind of back and forth in this, I kind of like, because I think at the beginning I was also a bit afraid that it looked too much like a sort of like a rundown prostitution room, which I mean is definitely one side connotation that is still in there, but I think what was then better was that it was actually possible to go through different modes, and also surprisingly that sometimes, at least I remember that I found it actually quite beautiful to do it, and that I at some point just really zoned out and after 5 minutes thought, okay, we've been doing a lot of this mask touching now.
Interesting with the glasses, because when you wear them you have not the full side, you have like only like this, and when you perform and you have more time to get used to that, you're in a situation to surprise the people who come in, because they don't see you coming close. Also there's mostly noise or music, and you can just come there and then they're totally shocked and surprised. So it also gives you some influence over the person.
Yeah, that's true. Totally. All right. Perhaps in order to cover at least each room very briefly. Now I propose to move forward. And first show this room. This room is called the Sleepers. That's also kind of synchronized with light and sound, with three performers in it. That's the one with all the mattresses, and there we actually were laying the carpet also and hanging the lights and everything. And I'm gonna show a small section from that. That actually is a pretty beautiful overlap, which is just a transmission from another room, which happens by accident at that moment. All right. So there are a few things that this room had to offer. One small section is this thing where you handed out pills and then can decide what you do with them. Then there's another section which I think can stand as an example for some of the performative parts, where the audience actually was, put in a position that they felt like they had to help the people in the room, the performers. So one example of that would be this one.
Yeah, I want to help them.
So, in all briefness, those are two moments from this room. So, one part of it was the necessity to kind of possibly to help, but it also had a strangely kind of, that is one of the rooms that has this sort of synchronized feeling to it. So the lights and the movements also here were not as precise as in the room that we watched before, but there was a straight logic in it. So there were moments when things were happening and then that the people would crawl towards the visitor. So it was clear that there was something synchronized behind it. And this whole setting, it had sort of this rundown cellar room, sleeping room feel to it, which for some people seemed creepy, for some people actually found it beautiful. So it had different connotations, and that actually is something that happens for a lot of the rooms, that the way how people perceive it or evaluate it really differs quite a bit, this whether to be scared by it or whether to find it interesting or to find it beautiful. We saw one very short section of this room already too.
Starry night's in here.
Starry night, yeah.
And there's a woman.
Do you want to sit down?
Okay.
Could you please lift up the fork and break it? Your hands.
She has
not to?
Doesn't she?
Yes.
Isn't she just shaking?
No.
Maybe if you give her the nail polish, maybe she will be happy.
Okay.
Yeah, try that. Try that.
To break the fork?
Yeah.
Okay.
All right, I'll jump to one little other question, a little other section, and then I'll say a few words about it. So this example perhaps stands for two things again. For one is that when you enter this room, you have like those five objects, and each of them is there twice. So it's very clear that, and there's an open chair, that you're supposed to do something with this. But the rules are again not really clear, or there's no real super logic to it. But as you engage with it, what actually happens is that when you touch something, in that case, Carola, who's the performer, our clarinet player from Dakota, that she then would repeat this movement over and over again. So if I would just do this, then she would do this movement as long or until the moment that you do something else. And if you touch something, then it would lead to something that we saw there. So. But she would get stuck in a loop like this. So actually meaning that some of the things were, for her, it was also super exhausting. And a bit similar to what we saw before in the sleeper's room, it also created the feeling in the audience that they sort of were responsible a bit for what was happening there. So the idea behind this was that what the performer does here is actually depending or lies in the hands of the performer. So it's a question then again how to how to engage in the situation and how to find a way to make it work for you. And there's, as in the other things also, there's no clear goal in those things. There's also never like a real solution. So the whole thing rather, or the whole work in itself rather, depicts some strange worlds with certain functionalities and certain rules, but it doesn't really offer. There's no bigger narration, and that is perhaps also an important thing to say. Something that we've also been also with Heinrich, who took part in the dramaturgy as well. We've been discussing back and forth how to design a thing like this, because all those situations also, of course, have a sort of theatrical side to it, and also imply some sort of like story or narration, and that is something that we tried to explicitly avoid, not to make it a theater play. Not all the people that we see there are not supposed to be characters, and nobody here has a backstory or like a formal life or something like this. So this woman there is not, we don't need to know anything about what she has done before or after, but it's rather about the concrete interaction and about the systemizing of it. Or I don't know, Heinrich, how would you, or do you have an opinion on this?
Maybe something interesting about the room to say is that this, the responsibility of the audience there is, gets so clear in that situation and they can't really escape it. Mm. And I think that was something which was interesting to us, that that they weren't able to stop her somehow, so they could only escape the room, so they could only leave the situation and leave her alone. And I think that's also one point of the, one interesting point in the performance, that we have these rooms where you can only leave the situation, you can't change it and you can't intervene. And and as Carola is always reacting on what the audience is doing, for us it was
it was necessary to not create a narrative around it. So she's really free to interact and to not have like a, also she doesn't have a goal, she doesn't know how she's going to react. I think it was always really different to the people who entered the room.
And it's also, I mean, I think this also has two sides. One is what comes across for the audience. The other thing is also when developing the piece, I know that we also, when working together in the group, always had this discussion also how to motivate what we are doing there. So there's always also always been a back and forth, or how can you, you know, bring this across, bring this to life, also sort of make it your own, but so that you find an angle for yourself, but an angle that is not based on a character.
I think what was interesting, and maybe also the reason why we decided to not have this narrative and not have like a certain, not to push a certain kind of feeling or that it's especially scary or especially charming or whatever, that what you described before, that the perceiving of the rooms really changed in relating to the audience, was that the audience in itself started to talk a lot about feelings.
Yeah.
I think that's something really interesting, that the controller and the people who are, the person who's walking in the installation, that they started to talk about their feelings because we kind of didn't implement them in the rooms. So they really, I mean, that was something surprising to me, or I think to all of us, that they really, had, in a way, it felt like they had the need to talk about how they feel about things.
I think one of the most common phrasings actually was, how does that make you feel?
Yeah, exactly.
So
yeah.
That is what a lot of people, like a lot of the people from the control rooms often said, yeah.
And I think that's interesting to really leave the decision about how you feel as an audience at the audience side. So we as the team who is creating this work is not deciding about how things does make you feel, but it's really on your side, on the people who watch you. I think that's a really interesting point about this work.
Absolutely. All right. I'll power through the last rooms, which I can really just show like brief excerpts of now. Here's one room that looks like this.
Okay. What do I do now?
You can go forward to the people and join them.
Okay. Okay.
And you have to stay in this room and engage quietly. Engage the group.
Alright, I'll make a quick jump to another section. We got a feeling here, the room for a certain reason is called ritual, so it's clear that it's more like a collective thing that you do together. And so like a lot of the clear interaction rooms are more like one-on-one situations, and this one's has a bit more of a group feel to it. I was hoping it would come, I think, in a bit later. Also, there's a choreography with the faces, so it goes from super heavy smiling to a stern expression again. So it's that definitely came across weird. So there are two rooms left, and I'll try to very quickly give you an overview over those two. One is in a big room. There was like a huge pile of trash, and in the center of that there was a tent, and in that tent there was one performer, and we can take a very quick look at this.
sleeping, I guess. Why? What? Oh.
I'll quickly jump to a second section. So perhaps two examples that are not just from the sort of scary world, but there's actually a broader range of quite like intimate and fairly beautiful scenes as well. Some of them were planned, some of them weren't planned, and it's... Especially for those, what I found interesting is how it's different when you're, for example, really in this tent, or whether you see it through one layer from the through a screen. Because I'm not even actually 100% sure if the more intimate one is the one if you're really in the tent, or whether the other one is more intimate. It's weirdly, you so strongly kind of engage into this perspective, and for some reason it makes it feel at least as close, or in a different way close to the person that is in front of you, and to have the possibility to realize that and to experience that is something I found interesting for this room, or basically actually for the majority of the rooms. And I guess we are sort of running out of time. I'll just show you a very short moment of the last room, which I meant to show.
Should I do the same thing?
So that is more or less the last room. So this is kind of, as you might have seen, a kind of a strange form of fitness exercise that you do together with somebody else. And that more or less rounds it up of all the rooms that were available. The one thing I didn't show now was this climax room where everybody would go in the center room.
And
the strobe room. The thing is, the strobe room, the documentation for that one is so shaky, but you're right. That actually is also missing. So both the rooms with the strong strobe lights are not in here now. But perhaps that actually also is a good transition to one question associated to that. So one thing about that thing was how to design the piece itself, but then also the question then later came, what a good form of documentation for a piece like that would be. I'm not sure if somebody here of you already seen this web page. So on that, if you go on that, you have just a constant stream of those first person perspectives, and it sort of just kind of recreates the how it was while the installation was really running. So in the tech room where we were sitting, actually we would see exactly something like this. And what I liked about this is that you can't press pause or you can't rewind and something like this. So it's just a constant stream. It's a bit like you have, or it's mimicked to look like a surveillance cam monitor, so to say. And it gives you the possibility to sort of constantly, whenever you want to, just look what is happening. And the whole documentation, in a sense, was a challenge because we recorded both days. So that was 6 hours and 4 cameras each, plus the control room. So we had, I think, like something like 100 hours of video material. But so this is how it's... that for me is like the main documentation of the piece. There's a trailer and like a video documentation. But what actually, in my eyes, does the piece most justice is just looking at the kind of unedited material. And in this sort of continuous way. All right, so before I wrap up, here's... I think most of the people involved I've already mentioned or are even here. Also with Karl-John Hoffmann, who did all the wireless video stuff that was super important for the realization of the piece. And also Dani Cassadi, who did the tech assistance. And so you can see it's been a big team of people, but the task was even bigger than we did have experts for. As Sonja already mentioned, it actually meant that we had to do everything in parallel all the time, which was a challenge, but in the end also rewarding, I thought. So, if I sum up, the topics I wanted to bring across are the different forms of control, hierarchy, and especially virtuality. This way of closeness and intimacy and looking at somebody else and through somebody else's eyes in different ways. And so the role of the body and the social interaction in those settings under different circumstances of distance through technology is, I would say, the driving factor behind the piece. And to create something that is open enough for strong interaction, but still has the possibility to bring some core features of a composed artwork across. And I think there would be quite a few other things left to say, but perhaps I'll leave it at this and would perhaps open the round for questions if there are any left. In any case, I'd like to say thank you for listening, and if you have any additional questions, we are, I guess, happy to answer them. Yes?
How do you thought about the music? Like, what's the role of the music?
Yes, that is a very good question. And will not believe it or not, have even prepared a slide for it. The role of the music functions very much as to support this sort of system that synchronizes everything on top. So it's in some parts it also works as a kind of accompaniment, you could say, but the main factor of how the music is used is that it's there to organize time and the performances and also the interactions. So there are a lot of moments where there are where the sound, and the sound is always linked with the lights, so it's also a thing how to drive the perception and the navigation and the interaction of the users, the audience. So so it is in a way pretty functional, but also very necessary to actually bring this to make this thing work the way it is. So the it kind of ties the thing together and gives supports the idea of that there's a logic, some organizational thing, the synchronicity, and the whole, let's say, the kind of the abstract world that it creates is strongly supported by this. And a lot of it is not so much clear musical, but it's more like cues, or like has a very sort of geometrical shape to it. So it's more like blocks and blocks of time. So it's rather thinking of composition as structuring events in time rather than a traditional music thinking. So it's composing in a way to organize also the space, because it worked with a lot of loudspeakers, and so it's designed to, as something to drive the perception of the participants. And perhaps on a side note, it's also, well, one question was obvious, whether or not to use instruments. And I think I was pretty sure from the beginning on that I would rather not do that. We made a few like super short tests, but I think the test consisted of unpacking the violin and then packing the violin back into the case and the cello. So I tried to explain a bit before, the question, is it a concert, is it a performance, or is it a theater piece? And it's not supposed, I didn't want it to be a theater piece in the sense that it would narrate a story, but I definitely didn't want it to be like a, like those kind of performances or concert performances where you wander around a building and then get a little bit of concert here and a little nice performance there. That for me was like the work, like the opposite of what I wanted to achieve. And then in this setting, I would find it difficult to have a reason to have an instrument there. So the only reason, or the only mode, I think, that could work, and that is actually something that I plan for a follow-up piece, is if it would be something like, so for example, there was a pile of metal and something to hit on it. So, and one of the performers sometimes did it, but the audience could also do it. And something I plan for a future piece is that, for example, if there's just a piano somewhere standing there and everybody could just interact with it like that, then I could see it also to work with an instrument. But if it's like an object that is part, and that is part of the setting, and that is also justifiable an object and not an outside object. And if that is the case, and if the interaction form would be as open as that, then I could also see the use of an instrument in there. But yeah, I mean, obviously, for a commission from a music festival, of course, it was also a untypical in a way, that there was no live playing at all, aside from the piano.
But organizing the rooms and the ideas of the room, you were thinking further about which music you take and what event is going to take place?
Yes. It was in parallel. So it was definitely not music, and then we made a performance based on it. If anything, then the other way around. Actually, what was there was the idea of the rooms and the concept of the piece was there way before the first music was there. So in that case, yeah, the interaction and the kind of the system of the piece was definitely was the core of the piece. And then at some point, actually then the music also became super helpful as this kind of organizational tool, because for some things we were then also trying back and forth. And then I found it super helpful as a my mode of working to just say, okay, I'm going to put this sound of this block of sound here, then there's a silence, then there's three events happening like this. And actually that actually then also made the development of the performance and the interaction modes in some of the rooms easier once there was some framework to relate to. Any other questions? Something what happened?
Really weird or really
violent? Really violent? Well, fortunately not.
I think one thing for me was kind of violent. When this one person wanted to exit and the controller said that they can't.
Ah, that's right.
So there was one audience member walking through the installation, and then at some point she said that she's scared and that she wants to leave. Mm-hmm. And the person in the control room said that she can't, that she has to continue. And that was kind of...
Yeah.
And said there's no way out.
Oh, there's no way out. Yeah, for me it was more the action that someone is really not taking. I mean, in general I would say they were like super caring, super sensitive, and like in a way also sweet and nice to each other. But that was really a moment where I was like also a bit shocked about that people just say, I'm sorry, no. And she was really, really scared. Like it wasn't pretending. She wanted to leave.
But I mean, that was also the reason why we had the safe word and why we were also listening into the conversations, so that if that happened, we could also intervene. So,
yeah, I mean, we didn't, but I would say that was a situation which was kind of violent.
Mm. Yeah, because I saw the video that somebody just audience throw the garbage to the others, like the kingdom and something like that. So, I just don't know.
And weird things happen a lot.
Yeah, weird things happen for sure.
I mean, it's not normal social behavior, no. But I think the people have the feeling they enter like a video game or they, with real people and real situations.
Yeah.
So that's the thing you feel, that they don't treat you like they would treat you in normal life.
Because I was thinking about it, because if you control somebody, you will definitely want to do something doesn't dare to do.
Yeah, you're more brave, probably.
Yeah.
Mm. Yeah, I think it's different. Like, I think for some people might have had this feeling. Some people actually, I think, just felt sympathetic for the people and just said, kind of more try to help them make the experience as good as possible for them. So, yeah, the range was actually quite broad, the palette of how the people interacted.
And also, Heinrich's experience helped a lot. Actually, when we were discussing before the thing, what do we do if they touch us in a not respectful way, or when they're weird and in this close room, some of us were alone in their rooms, so it's also special. But Heinrich always said, you will feel if somebody is really not okay and not somehow weird or not responsible in the situation, you will feel it immediately. And I think nobody from us had to even
have
a situation that they want to stop or to escape.
Mm. All right. Should we wrap it up? I think we are over. So thank you for your interest and. Yeah, thanks. But also thanks for Sonja, Pedro and Heinrich for being here and shedding some light on your perspectives too.